Welcome to the very first chapter in the module Grid-Connected PV System. In this chapter, we will learn how solar cells work. Since most solar cells are made of silicon, we'll use silicon as an example. In this first lesson, we'll first have a look at different atomic models. First of all, let's take a look at the silicon atom as it is presented in Bohr's atomic model. In this model, there are discrete shells, each of which has a certain number of electrons orbiting the nucleus. The silicon atom has three shells. There are two electrons in the innermost shell. This shell is fully occupied. The second shell is also fully occupied with 8 electrons. However, there are only 4 electrons in the third shell. If the shell were fully occupied, there would still be 4 more electrons. A further development of Bohr's atomic model is the orbital model. Unlike in Bohr's atomic model, the electrons here do not move in circles around the atomic nucleus. Instead, only a certain probability is given for each electron with which it would be found at a certain location. This probability is described by the orbitals. The simplest orbital has the shape of a sphere. It is the so-called S orbital. For us, the dumbbell-shaped P orbitals are also important. They can have 3 different orientations. The first shell of Bohr's atom model corresponds to an S orbital in the orbital model. We call it the 1s orbital. The second shell consists of a 2s orbital and 3 p orbitals. The third shell is constructed in exactly the same way as the second, but for the sake of clarity, we no longer show it in the 3-dimensional model. For us, however, the shape of the orbitals is only of secondary importance. What actually interests us is the energy of the electrons. We can assign specific energies to the electrons of the different orbitals. Similar to Bohr's atomic model, only discrete energies are possible. An electron bound to the nucleus can therefore only occupy certain energy levels. The electrons in the S orbital of the first shell have the lowest energy. Next comes the energy level of the S orbitals of the second shell. And with a slightly higher energy level, the P orbitals of the second shell. It is the same with the orbitals of the third shell. However, there cannot be any number of electrons in an orbital. According to the so-called Pauli principle, the electrons in an atom must differ in at least 1 quantum state. The only quantum state in which the electrons can differ within an orbital is the spin, in other words, the sense of rotation. It can take on exactly 2 values, donated spin up or spin down. Therefore, only 2 electrons can reside in each orbital. Let's look at the energies of the electrons in a silicon atom. The silicon atom has a total of 14 electrons. The electrons always assume the energetically most favorable state in the atom. This means that the shells in this representation are filled from bottom to top. As we've already seen in Bohr's atomic model, the p orbitals of the third shell are not fully occupied. The electrons in this not fully occupied energy level are called valence electrons. All atoms strive to either fill up their outermost shell or lose enough valence electrons to expose the next lower shell. This state is called the noble gas configuration. In order to reach this configuration, atoms form a chemical bond with other atoms. Let's take silicon as an example. Silicon has 4 valence electrons. In order to reach the noble gas configuration, it lacks 4 electrons. Therefore, it forms a bond, for example, with other silicon atoms. In a silicon crystal, each silicon atom is surrounded by 4 neighboring silicon atoms. Silicon atom now shares one of its 4 valence electrons with each of these neighboring atoms. The other silicon atoms also share their valence electrons. This type of bond, where 2 valence electrons are shared, is called a covalent bond. However, the single atom thinks that it owns both electrons and thus has reached the noble gas configuration. Such a bond in which the noble gas configuration is reached is very stable. The electrons are very strongly bound here. Let's look at the 3-dimensional representation of a silicon crystal. You can see that the neighboring atoms do not arrange themselves in a flat plane around the silicon atom. Instead, together they form a tetrahedron. A 3-dimensional silicon crystal is composed of many of these tetrahedra. Let's look at how the electron energies behave in a silicon crystal. Here you can see again the energy levels in a single silicon atom. Because of the Pauli principle, there can only be 2 electrons in each orbital. We now consider the energy states of 2 silicon atoms. At some distance from each other, both have the same orbitals with identical occupation. However, if we bring them very close together, their orbitals overlap. The electrons of this 2 silicon molecule can no longer occupy the energetically most favorable position because they are already occupied and, based on the Pauli principle, must not be occupied twice. This leads to the splitting of the energy levels. So we now have twice as many energy states as in a single atom. Now let's look at a crystal lattice made up of billions of atoms. In this crystal lattice, the energy levels split so far that permitted energy areas arise, the energy bands. In these energy bands, the various discrete energy levels can hardly be separated from one another. Let's take a closer look at the energy bands. The highest energy band, in which all states are occupied by electrons, we call the valence band. The lowest band, in which not all states are occupied, we call the conduction band. Here you can see the usual representation of the energy bands in a semiconductor or insulator. Energy bands below the valence band are usually not mapped. The distance between the upper edge of the valence band and the lower edge of the conduction band is called the band gap. There are no allowed energy states for electrons in this region. At a temperature of 0 Kelvin, that is at absolute 0, there are no electrons in the conduction band of the silicon crystal. As the temperature rises, individual electrons are excited and can enter the conduction bands. These electrons can leave unoccupied energy states in the valence band. The unoccupied energy states are called holes. We have now learned how energy bands and band gaps arise. In the individual atom, there are discrete energy states that the various electrons can assume. In a crystal lattice, these energy states split into continuous energy bands. The last fully occupied energy band is called the valence band. The first band that is not completely filled is the conduction band. The distance between the valence and the conduction bands is called the band gap. In the next learning unit, we'll take a closer look at the semiconductor and its energy bands. I thank you for your attention.